All right, if that case, we are happy if we crack on. So again, the first item is to consider whether we've got any disclosable pecuniary interest and or relevant interest in connection with any of the items on the agenda. Yeah.
Item 6.
Management approach of all one party executive.
That will not be the same in the new system, and indeed risk management is included in all of the committee's terms of reference, in particular policy and resources. So there is a slight change in that relationship. And it's noted up and down the country that that has resulted in a change of the structure of audit and risk management committees, in as much as most councils that have changed to a committee system have combined one or more of constitution committee, standards committee and audit. Some have created one committee to three, called the governance committee. Others have put standards and audit together and left the constitution committee standing on its own. Some have kept the separate audit committee and dealt with the others differently. So it's just putting across to you that there is that change. You may want to think about that and make a recommendation to the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee and their member working group when they're coming to design the committees.
Thank you. Has anyone got any comments? My own view for what it's worth, to move things along a bit, is that having read through it, again, not carefully, it looks like it becomes quite a passive committee where it's spent a bit of time developing under Adrian and continue through to be a bit more optimistic, to get involved in some of the issues that need to be got involved in, as well as the purely financial side of just monitoring whether the public purse is being properly protected. So I would be loath for it to drift back to just a kind of, you know, adjunct of the finance committee. But that's my own goal. I think what we need to do, and as I understand it, Mr. Cllr, we will all have the opportunity to comment on the new structure of the committee system and what the various roles are as they go along. There'll be quite a wide consultation process.
Mr. Chair, at the moment, because of the speed at which we're doing it, that's led by the member working group and the representatives of each party on the member working group are adopting their own processes for discussing back with their group. We as officers have offered whatever support is needed in that process. Hopefully we will get at least one all-member workshop, and this afternoon the LGA and member peers have also offered their assistance to groups.
Can I make the suggestion to move along? I think Mr. Cllr for this report. It's an interesting start to tell. Personally, I like the idea of having, you know, independent representation, or an independent voice on the committee. Obviously we're all independent, we can hear also. But that people take away, read it, and then make their own, each group make their own representations around this as it comes forward, and then we can take it view as it gets more shape. Does that seem to work for you, Mr. Cllr?
For the avoidance of conflict of interest and in the spirit of openness, I need to declare I'm a member of that working group, and therefore happily take advice on whether I should actually vote on this item, because I'll be considering it somewhere.
Hopefully it's not going to come to a vote, it's just going to come to, well, that's the process, but I'm sure Ian will be in the same boat. Gillian? Cool. Are people content with that approach? That we thank you relentlessly for the start of the town. We feed this into the process that's looking at the new committee system, and that each, as that comes forward, all of us have the opportunity to feed into that process if we think it needs strengthening here or weakening there or whatever it is. Does that seem a reasonable approach? Okay, thank you very much. So we'll do that then with everyone's, all the members of those bodies noted. And that would include members who are able to combine some of this stuff also to keep the purity of purpose. All right, thanks very much. Next item I've got then is the whistleblowing procedure review. And somebody's going to talk to us, Nicholas. Mr. O'Neill, you're going to introduce this report for us, is that right?
Okay,
where you go.
Good evening, members. This report
Council currently manages whistleblowing concerns. It advises the committee on the progress of the Council's current whistleblowing project, which was commissioned in October 2018, and the project timetable is outlined in the body of the report. Members are invited to note the report, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay, just as a bit of a starting point, I'm sure everyone remembers, and Phil, you were strong on this too, in terms of some of the issues that have arisen. I got to know about some of this sort of stuff tangentially, and so I had no idea how many whistleblowing cases that we had, how long they were had been going on for, and whether what particular stages they were at. I didn't want to know the cases because that would be inappropriate. But I thought there was at least some sort of need for some sort of oversight, so as we could hold everyone to account that whistleblowers are getting a good deal from the point of view of being treated appropriately. I know that something came up, didn't it, which was linked subsequently. So I think this is really important. I think Mr. O'Neill has outlined the where we're going to get to. I think you've also outlined that our current practice doesn't align anywhere near to best practice, and that something is being done about it. I'll at that point hand it over for the questions. Phil, I know you've been quite heavily involved.
Thank you. Those of us have been around for perhaps longer than some members appreciate, and recall the history of the issues that really came to a head in social services at one time, and probably still have a copy of the very thick report carried out by people from the North West who interviewed the gentleman who was the whistleblower at the time, will want to ensure some assurance that what happened to that individual could not happen to employees now, and has not happened to employees since, we hope, because, I'll try to put it this politely, the gentleman felt that he was assigned menial tasks, sent to work in a far-flung office with no oversight, and felt very much undervalued at the time. And the report from the North West people were very strong on what ought to have happened. Of course, subsequently, that gentleman, under the regime of Mr. Burgess, there were interviews about would it be possible for that individual to come back to work, and in the end, I think the gentleman himself thought it wasn't likely. So, given the assurances in the report that there's no detriment to somebody's career, that they can feel free to raise things, that they're not going to suffer, their prospects aren't going to suffer, and that if they genuinely raise something, believing that there is a problem, and in the end it turns out not to be a problem, they don't suffer from having done it. They're the assurances that we're now given, that the committee needs a periodic report to test the price of what in practice.
Yeah. Anybody else want to say? Go on. Yeah, Adrian.
I don't disagree with what Phil is saying, but those of us who were closely involved will be aware that there were more whistleblowers than one. And that if you were to make a case study of what happened, it would be a very interesting one. But I think it would be wrong to go into the detail now, so I'll have to be there too.
Yeah, and again, I think, as people often point out, obviously, the things that brought it all back onto the table again in terms of the Cllr report, etc., and the fallout from that. I think Phil and Adrian are right, that's the standard in terms of the no detriment, the welcoming of an opportunity if something's going wrong. And I think later on, I've been particularly keen to get a compliance risk put into the risk register to make sure that people abide and comply with our policies and procedures, and where people are whistleblowing, whistleblowers and the subsequent investigations, if that's what it be, are being properly timed. Those, you know, they are being properly investigated within a set time and so on and so forth. So we can monitor that the process is working as it should. So I think we probably need to have a think about, or I'm sure Mr. O'Neill will have a think about, where that should be. So as well as the periodic report here and so on, you already get that to a certain extent. It's the how are we tracking those to make sure that they are being properly followed. And also, again, you know, you have a bit of a history of this, don't we, in terms of there was one occasion where, about two now, before I can tell, where whistleblowers' names were released to people that they shouldn't have been. So that confidentiality was breached also. You know, we need to know that where that happens, then form management steps and also taking around that. And, you know, people comply with what the policy says. So some of the points, I don't know if you want to come back to us, Mr. O'Neill, with your thoughts on our points.
Through you, Chair. The periods that the report will come to this committee will be quarterly. There will be more detail in the reports, especially surrounding the items that you've just mentioned in terms of the timeline, the use of money concerns to be dealt with, so the committee will assure that we are having a tight rein on the management of the whistleblowing concerns. I'm in the process of drafting the new policy as we speak, which will go to concern. Will be benchmarked by the end of next month to come back to this committee early next year, where the committee will have the opportunity to have a meeting with it.
Okay. And obviously we are tight for time. I'm going to give you the opportunity, Mr. O'Neill, because we don't always get to celebrate success, but did you say to me when we were talking about this, that actually the national body that's looking at this thinks that we're really getting a grip of the issue, but they want to use us as some sort of, you know, beacon or role model or one of those sorts of things, rest of the country?
That's correct, Chair. We've been, as the report says, we've been liaising with the tech for some time now, and it's due to the fact that we've really embraced the philosophy and encouraged whistleblowing as part of our risk portfolio. Protect have identified the council as an organisation that they want to be at the forefront of whistleblowing throughout the UK, and hold us up, as the Pastor Chair says, as someone who takes this part of their risk portfolio extremely seriously.
Alright, thank you to you and the team that have been putting this work in to get us to a position. I think we all agree that we want to be, as opposed to where we have been or even where we might be now. So, thank you very much for that. So we know the report and await the further developments and support for the work that has been doing. Thank you very much. Next item I've got here now is Forms and Manner High Court Judgment, which is starts on page 57, I think. Says here. So, Interim Director of Economic and Housing Growth is going to introduce this for us. Or he's going to be really clever and try and slope his shoulder to somebody else. Mr. Ball, are you going to deal with it?
Yes, I am going to deal with this item. Thank you, Chair. Good evening, members. This report seeks to provide members with assurance that the Council is taking appropriate measures to address the criticisms set out in the recent Court of Appeal judgment in this matter. The report has three parts to it. Section 2 of the report explains the background to the Court hearings. Section 3 explains the Court proceedings themselves. And Section 4 explains the present position following the redetermination of the planning application. I apologise for the errors that have been made in this case with regards to the planning decision notice that was issued without conditions. As officers, when we became aware of this, we immediately sought Council's advice and reported it to the Planning Committee, so we've been open and transparent about that error. out in the judgment, and that we continue to review those systems and look to ensure that nothing like this happens again. And I'm happy to answer any questions, Chair. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that, Mr. Ball. I'm sure there's going to be some questions, and I'm sure Alan's here to answer some as well. But it strikes me as this was sent to us by the planning committee, was this? So that's why we were asked to look at this, particularly around the costs. Now, notice on the costs, what we tended to do on this is to highlight what we've given to other people to do things, as opposed to be a full identification of all the costs. And whilst, you know, I suppose the thing is, if we're going to get assurance that it can't happen again, we're going to need a clear view that we have understood where we've the failings that we've made. And I know, speaking to Councillor Hodson around the issues around planning, I know she's got some specific concerns that she feels that not everything has been drawn out in that kind of planning. So, Cathy, did you have a few points, that some information you wanted to glean?
David, when you said that once the mistake came to light, you brought up the planning committee in 2017, I think it was, but the mistake was allegedly discovered in May 2012. So how can it be that the correct interest was apparently substituted without any thought to the potential consequences of the error? And why was the applicant seemingly not even contacted to advise that they'd been sent an incorrect planning decision? Surely somebody in authority doesn't know what's going on. What was the procedure at the time if an incorrect decision notice was sent out and the error was noticed? Was it just ignored, or would we rescind it and issue a correct one? The Court of Appeal felt that the Council could have done more in terms of the error that it made by using its statutory power of revocation under Section 97 of the 1990 Act, or the power to make a discontinuance order under Section 102 of the Act. And do we use these measures whenever a decision notice is sent out incorrectly? I understand that the Council decision not to take any action under these statutory powers, according to the judicial review, was due to the risk of a claim for compensation by Thornton Holdings. But the Appeal Court Judge, Justice Kerr, in his review, Section 66, found that the Thornton Manor had not suffered financially. I just go to 66 of the judicial review. He says that it follows that I'm not impressed by the argument that the interested party would be prejudiced by the grant of relief with it accepted bookings in good faith up to the year 2020 on the strength of the unconditional planning permission, which it had the benefit. He was only able to enjoy that benefit by keeping silent about the obvious error that had been made. Its decision to accept bookings at the time and the presence of the market would be even precarious was one made its own risk and peril. So Lord Justice Kerr has said that once the Wirral Council decided not to win the judicial review itself because of the threat of possible compensation from Thornton Holdings, that's not borne out by the judicial review. Also, I just want to go on to when Thornton Manor was given the planning commission, apparently one of the gentlemen at Thornton Manor knew on the 22nd of December 2011, 2 days after the planning application, the decision notice went out without any conditions, he knew that the planning decision notice with no conditions on it was incorrect. And the Lord Justice Kerr felt that he would have confirmed that with Thornton Manor. And also, the Section 106 agreement, which had been signed and put in force on the 11th of November 2011, incorporated the conditions which were signed by all parties. And the Section 106 agreement had stipulated that the 5-year temporary planning permission was to put the walled the gardens and the other gardens generally back to their Greater listed position, which is why they were granted, even though against the conduct policy, to have markings for 5 years. And the Section 106 agreement said that quarterly accounts must be submitted to Wirral Council together with schedules of work to prove what work had been done during that quarter and how much it had cost, and a full set of accounts to be submitted. Now, during the 5 years from November 2011 to December 2016, when the temporary permission was granted, there should have been 20 quarterly reviews. And I'm not sure how many, perhaps you could advise David, how many of those 20 quarterly reviews actually took place. And does the council have any confirmation that it can bring to the auditor risk that the 106 agreement was adhered to? And the point I'm making is that on the planning committee, we regularly enter into, well, yeah, developers and individuals to enter into a 106 agreement. And the point I'm going to make is that if a 106 agreement is entered into and the planning committee or the planning enforcement don't check, what is the point of a 106 agreement if people can just ignore it? The other issue, and lots of others, but I won't go over everything. But when it comes to costs, it says on the financial implications that the High Court and the Council ordered to pay 90% of fraud and calls, legal costs. My understanding is that the £30,973.90 statutory interest is actually 45% of fraud and calls costs. And it says in section 502 of the financial implications, it will be necessary to appoint Council to represent the Council at public inquiry, which will have some financial implications. This will be managed within current budget provision. And we don't know what the budget is that's been set for the judicial review. But when we asked for it, we brought to this committee in terms of how much it costs the local council rate pays to bring the, or to take part in the judicial review. We don't have any details of what Wirral Council has had to pay out, because the £30,973 is the cost of 45% of Thornton Hall's costs. It relates not at all to Wirral Council's costs. And so what I'd like to have brought to the committee is this. What was the total cost of the case from initial notification, threat of action, to final court of appeal judgment, and to include costings of all in-house costs related to officers' time, subsistence and travelling costs, barristers' costs of attending and preparing for court of appeal, barristers and borough solicitors' preparation prior to attending both the Court of Appeal in London and the High Court in Manchester, and in-house costs for High Court and Court of Appeal, the cost of the extensive internal investigation including all officers' time, which is mentioned in section 3.4. 8.4, it says, following an extensive internal investigation both of the development management information system, blah, blah, blah. So there's no costing of what that's cost, because that is directly in relation to the judicial review and the findings that's had to happen. And the cost of legal advice in respect of not using statutory powers due to the risk of a claim for compensation by quantum and details of the legal advice. So if we could have costings up all of that, because at the end of the day, this is rate payers money, and it's not just 30,000, it's substantially more, and I think we need to know, so that we can make sure that these cases never happen again, what the likely cost to the number of council is if things go pear-shaped in the planning department. The other thing I'd like to ask, because I'm not sure, is when the decision notice was originally 11th, 2011, why did it take to the 20th of December for it to actually be sent out? And when in May 2012 it was noticed that there were actually three decision notices on file and three decision notices on the web, when it was changed, that Lord Justice Kerr says that the planning register was manipulated. So when I would have thought if there were three decisions on the council web and three decisions on the file, didn't somebody think, oh, which one of these is the real one? I think we might have sent you the incorrect decision, which is that we're not sure which one sent you, because we've got three here.
And during the time that there was a three monthly reporting reviews under section 116, did nobody ever mention, and by the way, when these marquees come up for certain need to be removed in 5 years, did nobody mention that? Because apparently it's only after, well, 6 months after the 5 year expiry date, that somebody had a conversation with the water manager to say, you know, your marquees need to come down. Because you only had it for 5 years, that they went to a piece of paper and said, oh no, we've got a decision notice that's got no conditions on it whatsoever. I cannot believe in 5 years that nobody in the planning department and enforcement ever mentioned it was only a 5 year temporary planning permission. And to make sure that these things never happen again, we need to make sure that the procedures put in place are adhered to. And like I say, I can't believe that somebody in the planning department didn't ever think that those three ministers went out incorrectly, but maybe thought and then got the wrong one.
I'm going to call Phil in a second as well, but first, what I would like to do is to thank Cathy for the work she's done here. It's kind of, you know, what good councils do, investigate issues and make sure they get ventilated and we end up with full transparency. Because I think this committee is, my sense is that we have a responsibility to public purse as independent to make sure that the money that the council spends is being spent properly and wisely and that we are complying with all the relevant policies. I'll bring you back in, Cathy, then I'm going to go to Phil.
Just one more slight thing is that Martha said that in 2012 the error could have been rectified, which is what now, what, 7 years ago. But it also happened in 2006. The marquees were put up without planning permission in 2006, and they were refused permission in 2007. And so here we are, 12 years later, with an application that has never been sorted out. Two occasions to get it right, didn't come.
Thanks for that, Phil.
I'll speak more carefully. I was the chair of the planning committee on the night that this decision was made. It happened, it was on a split vote, as the report refers to. I've been back to the committee minutes, and we did actually spend, when I met up the moment, some considerable time on this, because I recall I kept asking officers for clarification on something. Essentially, the committee were presented with an idea that if these marquees were endorsed, money would be generated that would support not only the fabric, but also enable the restoration of the grounds. The committee papers we had at the time had appendices which showed employees of Lord Lever in the grounds in the 1920s with a boating lake and everything looking beautiful. We were told that this would help restore this and the place would be very welcoming again. But I've taken the opportunity to look back at the committee report. As I mentioned, it was quite a firm debate with a number of residents, about a dozen or so in the gallery, saying they were not happy about this proposal, thought it was detrimental to the peace and calm of the lake and the community. But the opposite case was that this would enable the building to be restored and become full of life and have a future. Now, I've looked at the conclusions of the committee report on that night, and they did say in that document the limiting of the consent to a period of 5 years would enable realistic monitoring and review of the financial situation and prevent the establishment of inappropriate structures in the Greenbelt for longer than necessary. English Heritage over the time needs to report slightly changed their view. They began to welcome that this might work, but it said English Heritage are clear in their advice to the local planning authority that should consent for the marquees be granted, an appropriate mechanism is incorporated within a section 106 agreement whereby the entire profit from marquees is used towards an identified and properly documented repair programme that would be closely monitored by the local planning authority. So this reinforces what Councillor Hodson is saying, is that very tough debate at the committee. It was approved on a majority vote. A document would normally have been issued, and you would think that, and of course, the commission's right to the actual paper document is in the hands of the applicant owners. The committee passed a resolution, but the actual bit of paper is in their hands, as I understand it, which seems to be quite an interesting, loophole. There's not a loophole, because that's apparently the established position, which surprised me. But that said, I would have thought that a debate which was so carefully monitored by residents and was so sensitive would have led to officers ensuring that every I and T was dotted and crossed or whatever. We're now in a situation many years later where the stable door shut, the horse is bolted, and various things have happened since. And my part on the night was in his chair to try and get an appropriate decision as I saw it. It wasn't what the majority wanted in the end, but it has many lessons for us.
Yeah, any more questions directly? If not, I'm going to ask. I think this cuts across two areas, which is the planning side, and then there's the legal side as well. So I think it's probably fair to ask David to lead off on the planning side, because it is quite a litany of missed opportunities, mistakes, incompetence, frankly, for all of us, by the council and a number of owners, and I think you've already apologised for that. But, do you want to pick up the observations by Cathy and Phil, if you can, please?
Yes, Charles, I'll try and pick up those points. Councillor Gilchrist has an advantage on me in that I wasn't responsible for planning at the time, back in 2011. And
so you're not Spartacus?
I'm just explaining to them that I'm not Spartacus in terms of that. So in terms of any questions specifically about the committee on that evening, I would need to go back and check on those matters. Trying to pick up the points that have been made. As I've already said, an error has been made here, for which I apologise. In terms of the requests from Councillor Hodson, in terms of the total cost of the case and all of those other matters that you raised, then yes, I'm happy to provide that information. Obviously, I don't have that with me tonight, but we can pull those things together. I can also look at the way in which Section 106 was administered in terms of quarterly reports and the other things as well for you, and that's no difficulty to do. In terms of the way in which the decision notice was issued, and there were three, we have reviewed the systems. As I understand it, at the time, the accolade system was new, and the way in which certain things were recorded and the officers responsible for making the various decisions, that was not possible for the system to record and to do, so it was difficult to track through who had actually done what. We've since amended the systems so that now we are able to track through each decision and who makes that and when it's made. So that should avoid the production of multiple decision notices in this case. What was interesting as we went through this is that the applicant was actually working with us to discharge the conditions. And that is one of the reasons why I don't think it was picked up earlier than it was, because we understood that as they were discharging the conditions, they were working off the decision notice that was issued as part of the 106, which did contain the 11 conditions that the planning committee agreed on that night. And it was only when we had that meeting with them and they showed the decision notice about the conditions that we sort of became aware of that. As I say, we did take immediate action. In terms of the legal questions around the legal advice that we took at the time. That was something that we took from council and also with our legal colleagues. That was the advice we acted upon at that moment in time. Now, that was before the judicial review proceedings had been taking place, and obviously before the judgment was issued. So we operated on the best information that we had and the best advice we had. Clearly, the judge in the case thought differently with regards to some of that advice, and obviously we will look at that for the future. I don't know if Phil wants to comment any more on the legal side of it, but that's my understanding of what we did in terms of the planning advice that we took and reacted on that legal advice. I think I'm trying to pick up as many of the points there so as I could remember in terms of what Councillor Hodson and Councillor Gilchrist have said.
Just to help the thing, David, so we've already, I think one of the key things that Cathy was asking for was this further, bringing back this further report with all the costs properly identified. You said you could certainly do that. You asked some specific questions around, you know, how do these things happen, and you said, again, happy to take people through that.
Yes.
List. So, that's why I was this little bit. Any more questions? I think you've more than discharged your duties, Mr. McCall, on the, some of those legal type issues that have been raised, particularly by Phil. Cathy, is there anything you want to add?
Yes, Chair. The report that's before you is about what happened when and how to prevent that happening in the future. And I think very rightly raised is the cost of what happens when things go wrong. We were in a position when it came to light that Thornton Manor were going to try and rely on what they knew to be an erroneous planning decision. What did we do about it? There was several variations to look at it. As pointed out, one of those is to revoke the planning permission and want to try and do neither of those were normal, and in fact, that still the view would have been far more expensive than this. This, however,